Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Jakub Svoboda. I'm from Czech Technical University, and I'll be speaking about this holographic 3D imaging. My motivation is to give an overview of the techniques that we use at our university, both holographic stereograms, as you can see on the left side and in the middle, and the classic analog holography techniques, as you can see here. This is the outline of my speech. After a short introduction, I'll be speaking about synthesis at the plane of the hologram, then synthesis at the eyepupil plane, and then some sort of synthesis in the classical analog holography. So I'd like to start with a sort of stereography. This is the setup we use for recording the 2D views of the object. We actually move the camera in a plane, so that it's the kind of same setup as we use for the writing of the hologram, so that we don't have to distort the image after taking it. And we can both take the images, of course, just in a one parallax or both parallaxes for some reflection holograms. The thing is, how do we create the hologram so that it creates the viewing zones for the observer to see the three-dimensional image? First approach is that we do the synthesis in the plane of the hologram with some kind of lithographic technique, that we divide the area in small small dots, and within the dots we do some diffraction stuff to create the viewing zone. The other approach is that we actually create the viewing zones at the plane where the observer will be. We create it as a master hologram, then transfer, copy it to the final hologram, and after developing, actually the viewer has the viewing zones in his eyes. So I'll start with the synthesis at the hologram plane. Actually, you have already seen the poster on Tuesday with this kind of technique. You will also hear more of on this technique tomorrow from my colleague Marek Škereň. So I will try to keep as brief as possible. How does it work? You divide, as I said, the hologram into tiny areas, which we call dots. These areas should be smaller than the resolution of the human eye, which means from the common viewing distance, it's like 0.1 millimeter, which, if we use some laser writing technique, is still big area to create some magic inside. We divide it into another smaller, we call micro dots, which we fill with the gratings, and then as we can tune the gratings, we can change, of course, the periodicity and the tilt of the gratings. We can use it for distributing the information into various directions, and therefore each point of the hologram is like able of creating, sending different information into different angles. Of course, still this area of that micro dot is still big enough to do something in it, so we use it for additive color mixing. You see it's like three gratings in it, one for red, one for green, one for blue. And here's an example, a picture from microscope of a real dot like this. You see those nine channels, and in this case actually it's the color was mixed just from two special colors. This is the scheme how the device works. We use 405 blue laser diode. We collimate it, then it's incident on a special light modulator where the image of the structure which should be recorded is uploaded, and then it's demagnified on the recording material, which we use photoresist. This is how the device looks like. Actually, it's an older brother of the device you could see at the, could have seen at the, in the poster. Demagnifies the image about 150 times. As I said, the elementary exposure area is about 100 times 100 micrometers. We can expose area up to about 50 square centimeters, and the speed is 1 centimeter per 30 minutes. These are examples of the holograms that we created using this machine. You can see it has pretty bright colors. the contrast is good, but the thing with these holograms is that we cannot reach a big area because of recording material has to be positioned with very high precision, and therefore the area is limited. So that we wanted to obtain bigger holographic stereograms, for which we use this method, which we call synthesis at the eye pupil plane. This image you have already seen. Just to repeat, we create a master hologram which is divided into these viewing zones. Then we transfer it into the final hologram, and when the viewer observes it, he actually has these viewing zones in his eyes. How it works? There are several approaches. I would start with this one. If you display the two-dimensional images on some diffuser screen, and you put a shade with some aperture, which could be like this or could be a vertical strip, in front of the recording plate, you bring in a reference wave, and then you record this small area. Then you shift the shade to next position, record another pixel, and so on, so that you fill in the master hologram. Then you develop it, you replay it, and all the 2D images from the diffuser appear in the place where they were but during the recording, and they form a three-dimensional image, which you can, of course, again, record using a standard transfer scheme. And then after developing, you can see that three-dimensional image. Of course, up till now, I was talking about using laser light. If we use white light, what happens is that the image is distorted due to dispersion, which we can solve using common principles, like creating a rainbow hologram. You can see this is actually a photograph of the rainbow hologram, the rainbow master we made. Which, of course, loses the vertical parallax, but using this transmission hologram, you can actually see the image undistorted, and the vertical parallax is just used to separate the colors. Other way is, of course, making reflection hologram, which is spectrally selective, and just chooses a narrow band of spectra, and the image is seen undistorted. This is again a photograph of such a master we created. As I was speaking about dispersion, we can also take advantage of it. We use it for color mixing. So if you imagine this master is composed of three gratings like this, and each of the grating is made that way that it diffracts different color, different part of spectra into the direction of observer. We can do color mixing. Actually, we were using green laser. So if you see, if we use the green laser for recording, the red channel goes from the bottom, the green channel goes from the viewer, and the blue channel goes from top. As here, the colors are just to illustrate it. So we create a master like this. It's everything is on one plate. Then we transfer it to the final hologram. You have three signals coming from different direction. One reference beam create the three, let's say, gratings. And then if we reconstruct it with white light, we get this color mix in the direction of the observer. Actually, we use slightly different method from this because of we don't want to waste the energy on the shade. So we use this kind of projecting of the image from special light modulator through an objective to some distance plane, and we put the recording plate of the master hologram near to the output pupil of this objective. We bring in a reference wave, and we record this pixel. In this way, we just shift the stuff and record all the plate, and again develop, replay, and record. As we were building the device, it was necessary to decide actually what should move, and because we wanted the laser beams to stay in a place, we decided to move the plate, which of course brings some troubles because if you record the pixel like this, then you shift the plate, you also shift the image that has been already recorded, and we solve this by moving the specialized modulator in the opposite direction than the plate moves. Actually, the step of the specialized modulator is smaller by the ratio of the magnification of the objective. This is how the scheme look like. Laser is a kind of standard holographic scheme. We use collimated laser beam in the signal wave. We just slightly diffuse it. You can see both the XY tables holding the specialized modulator and the plate. And in the photograph, it looks like this. Here is the plate. Actually, the size of the master plate could be up to 30 times 40 centimeters. Actually, I have the biggest I have exposed is some 20 times 12 centimeters for the reflection hologram, which was big enough. And this is a detail of the XY table, which moves the specialized modulator. And these are the examples of the holograms that we made with this device. You can see a rainbow master. You can see a full parallax master for the reflection hologram, and the master for the color mix rainbow hologram. And these are the examples of the holograms that we made. Okay, you can see how big the holograms are. We also have some optical laboratory for classical image holography. We do holograms of size about 30 times 40 centimeters. We usually use green laser. Recently, we want to join the company of color holographers. So this is the last hologram we did, which is Denis Yuk full color hologram. And since we are a little bit into this area, we were asked to join this project of investigating kids' eye disease using holograms. I will explain how this device works. This is the kit. This is a beam splitter, and this is the camera which observes the eyes of the kid. And here's a hologram which has four images exposed into it. You have four different replay beams, and they switch rapidly between the replay beams, and the object moves from here to here. It's like a 2 meter distance to the plate. This is close to the plate, and the bucket from the digger moves up and down. And as they move it very fast, the kit is kind of forced to refocus, and they measure something which I don't exactly know what they measure. I don't have any images of the device, so I just explain how we did this hologram. We did it from two plates because the distance between the two objects was kind of far. And you have to have all the four images have to have the same efficiency. So we had to use two different plates with different conditions. And then we just stick the plates together and use it for this device. And to conclude, we at our department, we use these techniques. We use synthetic in the hologram plane, which is good for a high contrast of the image, for very bright colors. Of course, since it's a holographic stereogram, we can use an arbitrary object from computer. However, it is kind of limited in the area that you can use. For bigger areas, we use the synthesis at the eye plane, which, however, has lower contrast of the image, and it's kind of more complicated to do the color mixing. And in the classical holography, it's like the goodest that you can do kind of whatever you want, because you can build the setup how you would like to, but it's kind of time consuming. Good is that the image is like continuous, the change of the angle, it's not discretized, but the drawback is that you are kind of limited in choosing the object because you need the real object to record it. And I guess that's it. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. We have time for one or two questions, if there are questions for this speaker. Anyone wish to ask any questions? Well, thank you.